Good afternoon, everybody. The speaker is not going to talk in French. He's going to talk in English. So we have, I think we have a privilege and we have a pleasure to have Jean-Pierre Changer. He's a foreign member of the Academy and he's actually one of the very faithful foreign members of the Academy because he has been coming quite often to Italy, but also to Rome at the Academia. And we are very grateful for that. He's a widely known a neuroscientist, but he started the Pasteur Institute as a biochemist working in connection with Jacques Monod. Jacques Monod and François Jacob, two great personalities, two outstanding individuals that were at the forefront of science in the 60s, late 50s and 60s. And this is a reason for dedicating this conference to Jacques Monod. Jacques Monod is also well known because he wrote a famous book called Il caos e la necessità. Now, Jean-Pierre Changer started working on enzyme regulation, and while doing sort of regular biochemical experiments, activity measurements, he encountered some curious phenomena that at a time in which the structure of the enzymes was not known, essentially, and actually you may or may not realize that down on this poster there is a little drawing in white, and there it says L isoleucine L threonine. This is from his first paper by himself while he was studying this enzymatic reaction. He found, as I said, a curious phenomenon, and the models that he actually published and discussed that were the incipit of a lossary are shown there. And one of them says model one, overlapping, non-overlapping, and he will tell us about that. And without going through the story, maybe you'll say a few words. This actually brought to the formulation of a theory, the allosteric theory, and the publication of two papers in succession, but one of them in 1965 was the one I knew best because it was in collaboration, a collaboration between Monod, Changer, and Jeffrey Swyman that at the time was working in Rome on hemoglobin. And in fact, hemoglobin was used as a model system for cooperativity, which is the feature of the allosteric regulation. And he published pretty soon after that. He went to the States, changed topic completely, went into neurobiology, in fact, after a while. And he published a little paper that was a real jewel with Mary Rubin. Rubin and Changer was a paper in which he interpreted in terms of the allosteric model what is called in physiology, it's called the Bohr effect, which is the effect of pH on the oxygen delivery by hemoglobin. It was a very neat short paper in the Journal of Molecular Biology, but after that he worked quite a lot in the States and started working on the nicotinic receptor, also in collaboration partly with Riccardo Miledi, that I think has actually inspired several people. He was a nice person, Riccardo. Now, It's of course it would not be appropriate to start recalling, you know, the papers that he has been published ever since. But the wonderful thing is that he's still a very active scientist. He's published recently the structure of the nicotinic receptor and proceeded with, doing more recently work on the computational chemistry and molecular dynamics of these complex proteins, and he's going to talk about this, so I don't need to say very much more. But at the same time, he became, interested in the brain at large. He became interested in the modeling the brain and the higher cognitive functions of the brain, and this also became known through the publication of several interesting books. One of them, andiamo alla prossima, vado io. One of them is shown here, L'homme neuronal, and I think this is a nice picture of Jean-Pierre. And he has published several books, and including one where he dealt with an attempt to interpret the creativity in musical composition. So he has been ever since a very famous scientist. He has had a large number of recognition. He was the winner of Wolf Prize, a member of the National Academy, and a winner of the Balzan Prize. There is a long list here. I don't need to read it all. I mean, it's everywhere. And I will conclude by saying that he has been, due to the idea of allostery, which was the incipit was for a regulatory mechanism for enzyme activity, but then has extended ever since to biological regulation at large. He has been a famous scientist, and in fact he was a famous scientist ever since the very beginning. And if we can put the last of my pictures, this is when he started his work. He became very soon a famous scientist worldwide, and he has remained very bright, very alert, and full of humor, as it was in the 60s. And now, this is enough, and I think I now ask Jean-Pierre to take over and give us his talk. Thank you very much for coming, by the way.
Thank you very much, Maurizio, for this very generous introduction. And I am pleased to say that this lecture is dedicated to Jacques Monod, with whom I had a remarkable and extraordinary relationship. He was my tutor. He was my colleague since we worked together. And he has also been, I may say, a supporter, in the sense that he helped me throughout my career. And I may say that when he died, this was not only a loss for myself, for the Pasteur Institute, for France, but for science in general. He was really, if I may use the word, a genius in science. So I am especially pleased to dedicate this lecture to his memory, and also to show how good the relationship were in the Pasteur Institute. Here you can see for the 50th birthday, I was reading a poem to Jacques Monod, and here was François Jacob and François Gros. So at that time, we met with Jeffrey Wyman, and he, among other things, said, hemoglobin, like a beautiful woman, fascinating and ever attractive. And I show you here a picture of the woman in question, a little bit abstract, but I saw also the picture of somebody who has been really pioneer in the study of hemoglobin and who is a concrete actor in the field of hemoglobin. So the theme of my presentation today is a system biology approach for modeling the brain from genes to cognition. I wish to say that this presentation aimed at having I would say a cooperative impact in non-biologists, in particular in physicists, in mathematicians, in modelers, and also not only be followed by neuroscientists, but also by molecular biologists. And it is, I would say, multidisciplinary attempt, and yet perhaps at some stage you may encounter difficulties in trying to understand what I am going to say, because it's a little bit difficult to communicate in different disciplines without being precise each time. So this is, unfortunately, one of the difficulties in what I am going to talk about. But I would like to say that there have been attempts to use system biology to simulate, if one may be able to use the word, through a mathematical model, some biological systems. And the notion of system is going to Ludwig von Bertalanffy in 1968, and he was concerned by the fact that in nature there exist systems, in particular living organisms, which have to be considered as a whole composed of elements that interact with one another. And there is, according to Ludwig von Bertalanffy, for instance, in living organisms, a hierarchical order of complexity of open systems, systems which are physical but open to the outside world. And each level maintains its structure thanks to continuous change of components at the lower level. It means that, as I shall illustrate very soon at the beginning, not only elements which interact, but hierarchical order of elements which all interact with each other. And this is something that, from the physical point of view, Ilya Prigogine has been developing. I'm sure the physicists who are present here know about him, and also some neuroscientists like Francisco Varela and Umberto Maturana. Now, as I said, there have been attempts to develop a mathematical model of the whole cell, as you can see here, from the genome up to the cell boundary. And this was achieved from for a bacteria, Mycoplasma genitalium, and in 2012. And from this, a number of interesting predictions were developed, and in particular, the effect of genetic mutations on the organism. I don't want to say that this explains the cell, but I would say that it ruins the so-called vitalistic view that there is something which is inaccessible by science in the whole cell, and that the whole cell life can be accounted for by molecular mechanisms. And I think this is one of the most interesting outcome of the application of this system biology to the whole cell. Now, of course, the question is whether we should be able to extend these views to brain modeling. Now, first we have to appreciate the complexity of the brain. Well, this is this piece of tissues that we have in our skull that you recognize immediately, which is made up of about 80 billion cells, the nerve cells, which communicate with each other through synaptic contacts. There is, in the average, about 10,000 contacts per cell. So this is unique in the organism. At the level of the liver, of the stomach, each cell is in contact with 4, 5, maybe sometimes 10 other cells. Here is hundreds or thousands of cells which are in contact with each other. So it's a whole network with about 1 million of billions, 10 to the 15 synaptic contacts in the cerebral cortex. So it means that from the start, we are dealing with an extraordinary complex organization. And to please the physicists who are here, we are not having a random organization of all the synaptic contacts, but on the opposite, a highly ordered structure that we have to understand. And in particular, you can see here 180 specialized cortical areas, here for vision, audition, and the prefrontal cortex, which is involved more likely in cognition. And therefore, there is extreme specialization of the sets of neurons and contacts which contribute to these areas. And what is interesting is that during immunization, during the development of human beings from ancestors like monkey, chimps, and now, of course, Homo erectus and Homo habilis, then there is an increase of size and volume of the brain. I will illustrate that in a minute. And surprisingly, some of our colleagues say, oh, after all, this simply results from an increase in neuronal members. It's an extremely simple assumption, too simple to please us. Yet, you shall see that there are perhaps something in it. Now, there is, in a general manner, an extraordinary complexity of the human brain. And we have to produce simple models, otherwise we are lost. And this is the aim of my presentation today. Now, the overview of the human brain is schematized in this slide. And I view the brain as being a system of multiple interacting levels, which are all being involved in a Darwinian evolution from the molecular to the cognitive level. So let's see these levels of organization. At the lower level, the molecular level, at the gene for which compose the genome, there is a variability there, and this is due to the mutation, the translocation, whatever, and the time scale of 100 million years. Then there is another kind of evolution taking place from the fertilized egg up to the adult brain. And there is the development. And during this development, these 10 to the 15 synaptic contacts are being established. And I shall illustrate further that this is not taking place like if you were assembling a computer from preset circuits, not at all. This is progressively being developing through multiple nested steps of selection of synapses. I will come back on that. So the time scale is, let's say, hours, days, years. And one should emphasize that one of the very characteristic aspect of the development of the human brain, the development of this complexity I illustrated to start with, is the fact that the human brain developed in 14, 15, 18 years. So it's one of the very few species which originally was living, let's say, 30 years in Africa when Homo sapiens emerged. And the Homo sapiens was selected by Darwinian evolution to spend half of his own life to build this brain. So it's absolutely unique in the living world. Now there is also the dynamic of thought, which the spontaneous activity, I will come back on that to illustrate it. And there is also, of course, another kind of evolution, which is of importance, which is the social and cultural evolution, which goes from the variability of synaptic efficacies. When I am speaking to you, I am trying to convey some science, some culture, but it may last for, let's say, a few months, a few years, centuries, and sometimes 1,000 years. So this is an aspect which has also to be taken into consideration, and many of the physiologists of the brain forgot, except notable exception, we are here in with Professor Rizzolatti, that the human brain is in fact not only made up of molecular, cellular network levels, as you can see illustrated here, with interaction between the levels, but also is open to the social life and the cultural environment, to the conscious processing and rational thinking, and that language also, which according to Chomsky is unique to human being. And therefore, if we want to really understand the brain, we have to deal with not only the anatomical organization of the human brain, of the organization of the nerve cells together, but also to the relationship between the different levels of organization, and also to the relationship with the cultural and social environment, and take into consideration conscious processing, and of course, deal with language. So this is, if I may say, the system kind of view of the human brain, which, as I said, is not only unique as far as the complexity of the organization, but also of the relationship with the cultural environment and to the relationship between each other, which we may call the social life. Now, since everything, if I may say, in our brain is grounded on the molecular level, we are dealing with a physico-chemical machine, or system, I would prefer to say, which is operating in a projective style and with a considerable computational efficiency. And therefore, our aim is to try to understand what's happening from the molecular to the cognitive level, and conversely, how the cognitive level can affect the molecular one. So I will, in this presentation, deal with only a few aspects. It's so complex that I cannot deal with all the level of organization, as I said. I will deal, to start with the highest level, which is the conscious processing level and the language aspect, and in particular to two aspects that Noam Chomsky discussed, meaning with sound. I am not going to discuss that very much, but the issue of merge, which is the fact that the language is always producing items which are constantly new, the infinite use of finite means. So the second one, I will go back down to the molecular level, and then I will try to move progressively to the cognitive level. So then I will talk about the internalization of the socio-cultural environment, and then trying to link two levels, or several levels, to have ways to interlock the level of organization and try to finally suggest to you, and this might be a paradoxical conclusion, a minimalist model about the origin of the human brain. You shall be surprised by the simplicity, but I am presently trying to test for its plausibility, not to the reality, but the plausibility of this model. Now, I start by conscious processing, and very early on, I have been concerned by this, and in a lecture I gave to the Royal Society a long time ago, I suggested that one should, in fact, not consider consciousness as a unique phenomenon, that consciousness is the spirit or the soul or whatever, but this is a physiological phenomenon which possesses several levels of organization. One is the access to multiple states of vigilance, wakefulness, sleep, dreams. I hope you are not yet in the stage of sleep, but I will try to keep you awake for this presentation until the end. But this is clearly a state of consciousness. Now, you have another aspect, which is the capacity for the subjective experience of global integration of several sensory and cognitive functions. You are presently listening to me, looking at the slide, listening to me, and saying within yourself, what does he tell us? Is he right or wrong? Okay, so you have at least three aspects, three modalities which are linked together in one unique kind of system, which has some capacity for subjective experience. Then I will introduce something which is not common among scientists, is the reference to one of a beloved philosopher, who is Spinoza. And Spinoza said that we are animated, if you wish, by a spontaneous drive to survive, what he called the conatus. And I think it is part of the definition of conscious processing, because we are all trying to survive, even here in this room, for at least to get the most accurate and efficient knowledge about our brain. Now, the last, I will not emphasize it too much, but it's, of course, evident, is the capacity to interact socially with other agents, with self and other distinction. So these are, if I may say, hierarchical levels of conscious processing, which set up upon evolution and, of course, in the human being during these 15 years of postnatal development. And the newborn has not all these capacities I just illustrated here. They are progressively acquired during early postnatal development. So many scientists for decades have been concerned by the neurobiological architectures of conscious processing. And the first one is what I mentioned, the state of wakefulness, sleep, dream. And there have been the work of Penfield and Jasper, Hobson, Jones, and many others, and Jouvet, showing that there is a structure which is the pontine ascending reticular activating system, which is involved in the states of consciousness. So there is quite a good knowledge. There is also a good pharmacology, because I hope that you are not using too many of these pharmacological effectors which affect sleep, that you don't take a pill to sleep better after a day of work. It means simply that there is a pharmacology of consciousness, just to illustrate this point. And there is also the beautiful work of Linas and Paré and many others, who show that when looking at the physiology, there are different physiologic correlates between these different states of consciousness. Now, we have been more concerned by the processing of the conscious content. When I speak to you, not only you hear, you see, but you understand. So what's happening? There is some information which is being conveyed and which is conscious. And the question is, what are the architecture involved in conscious processing? And already Jasper in 1947 and even later has been already looking for that. And also looking for a characteristic pharmacology, and among it there is the role of a neurotransmitter. I mentioned the sleep pills, sleeping pills, but there are also some of you smoking. I saw that in the outside. So they are using acetylcholine to help concentrate or have an activatory effect on our conscious processing. And therefore, this was also proposed already on by Jasper and Christoph Koch and others. And during my teaching at the Collège de France, I read a book by Bernard Barthes. I was, of course, very much intrigued by the issue of the architectures of conscious processing. And there I found out in this book, which I recommend to you, it's pure psychology. It is some attempt to develop a theory about how conscious processing takes place in humans. And he proposed that there are processors, which are, for instance, visual, motor, and so on processors, which converge into a space which is global, a global workspace in the brain, and which is using to share the data and to process the data, and which is the seat for, if I may use the word, rational thinking. So this was a pure, I may say, psychological theory, and the only reference he gave as far as the neuroscience was to the reticular ascending formation. And I tried to think about it and try to modelize it together with Stanislas Dehaene, who was my student, and with whom I have been collaborating for about 20 years. And I had some meeting twice a month, and at one of these meetings I said to him, well, we should really go into this issue. Please read the book of Barthes. And my view is that we can find a simple way of having the neural basis for conscious processing. And the thing is that there are in the brain axons which are very long and which come from pyramidal cells for the cerebral cortex. And of course, the simple idea is that if we want to have a global, now neuronal workspace, because the Barthes was not neuronal, but now it is neuronal, then we should have in our brain ways to build a physical system which would create relationship between the different parts of the brain. And the minimal way to do it is to have connections which are involved, and these would be the long-range connections which were already seen by Santiago Ramón y Cajal in the pyramidal neuron from layer 2, 3, for instance, of the prefrontal cortex, but also other cortical areas. So this is an idea which was already implemented by Degerine in 1895, and which has been entirely confirmed by brain imaging from the group of the University College London, and recently by the work of Kennedy, Van Essen, and others, and which shows that there is in the brain indeed not only anatomical connectivity, but also functional connectivity. And you see the work of here of Von Economo, who already showed that these pyramidal neurons are not distributed equally throughout the cerebral cortex. I remember the different areas I showed you, and were present mostly in the prefrontal parieto-temporal cingulate cortex, and it means that this is also the case that you hear. And Patricia Goldman-Rakish already showed that there is indeed this kind of long-range network in the brain, which she proposed already to be involved in working memory. So this was only not about consciousness. And what we propose with Stanislas is that this kind of long-range network is, in fact, within our brain, being, I would say, a minimal neuronal organization together with the thalamocortical relationship in the global neuronal workspace. And very interestingly, if you look at the evolution of language, this is from Frederici and others who have been inspired by the work of Chomsky and others. And you can see here that there are indeed in the language areas some long-range connectivity which is involved. And this includes, of course, the mirror neuron of the LAT team. And you can further see that in the macaque to the chimp to the human, there is a very significant, if not dramatic, increase of this long-range connectivity. So this is at least consistent with some evolutionary data. And I may make a step further. This is, again, an hypothesis. If you remember the work of Miller, he said, in our working memory, then we can remember 7 items, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 items all together, no more, which is the magic number of the capacity of our brain in working memory. And the interesting thing is that many studies done with monkeys show that one of the main features which differentiate monkeys from ourselves is that monkeys are unable to articulate mental objects in their brain, only 1 or 2, while we are able to articulate sentences which are much longer thanks to the capacity of our work to keep in online several items in our global neural workspace. So this is an idea. I will continue on that and conclude on this at the end of my presentation. So the neural workspace hypothesis can be illustrated here. Again, the different processors here and the global workspace with the idea, in addition to Barr's kind of issue, that one can recruit representation in the global workspace by collecting information from the different processors, putting them together, and having what I call a global integration within this global neuronal workspace. Now, this is the main simple assumption. Again, this is a very simple Meidens kind of scheme. Specialized processors which are modular and automatic, I would say non-conscious, and the global workspace with long-range axon which broadcasts signals to multiple areas yielding subjective experience of being conscious. And there we have some system within the brain which would be able to carry on information processing with, of course, some limits about the number of items that we may organize to build up propositions or sentences. Now, another aspect which is very important in the theory that we developed, Stanislas and myself, is the importance of spontaneous activity. And I think most of the computer scientists, I imagine there are a few present here, are always discussing about the brain, if they are interested by the brain, as an input-output system, like a computer that I have in front of me. We introduce information, and the computer gave us back some information. Well, that's not the way the brain works. I said it is working at the very beginning in a projective style, and it's working in a projective style because there is an innate spontaneous activity which is taking place all the time, very early on, from the embryonic development and in the adult, which has been something very classical since the discovery of the EEG. The EEG shows that our brain is constantly active day and night. When it is silent, it's not a good sign, if I may say. So even during the night, some people think, oh, we are sleeping, the activity of the brain stops. No, it does not stop. It's different, but it's always there. So this spontaneous activity is very important. It has been further documented by Reichel and colleagues, and we have to think about this spontaneous activity. And even you may recognize in this so-called default network, which is the pattern of spontaneous activity in the brain, that there are some patterns which resemble the global neuronal workspace, as I mentioned before. So there is this spontaneous activity. And what I would like to come back now is to the Darwinian mechanism. How do you view the Darwinian? Well, but Darwinian means variation selection. There is a variability of the spontaneous activity, which I have called pre-representation. And then there would be some selection, which takes place through what Chomsky has called the merge process. So in me, it means that, in fact, in our projective style, we are constantly testing hypotheses on the outside world. Well, this is what I am trying to do with you, if I may say. And there will be some feedback, of course, positive or negative. But in a much, much more simple thing, and together with Stanislas, you always say, we have to model a task, and we have to select a cognitive task, and this is the one we selected to start with, where you have a set of words which are written with ink with different colors. It happens that these words are words of color. So when you ask to read this work and tell us the color of the ink, but you are to say yellow. No, it's not yellow, it's red. So spontaneously, the subject is making a mistake and correcting itself. So this is the cognitive task. And here, instead of reading red, you should say the color of the ink is blue. Okay. So this task can be modelized using the global neuronal workspace formalism I just presented before. And interestingly, we include here some, if I may say, epigenetic Darwinian mechanism where within the brain there would be a representation of, let's say, colors of words and so on. And what would happen is that according to the reward mechanism which is being involved here, then we select this representation and it is then stored in the working memory. So the proposal here is that in a task like this, one can build a computer model which can be simulated and according to which we have some kind of Darwinian mechanism in the process which is taking place to answer the task. And this is, I think, a very interesting aspect for those interested in language, because you may, of course, extend this kind of process to multiple representation and organize sentences and propositions and select them according to not only the inner reward, but also the reward you obtain through communication at the level of society. So this is a simulation to try to convince you. I'm sorry to be so fast. where here in this simulation, here is the activity in the global neuronal workspace. And you can see that to try to answer the task and pass the task, you have some search phase. Then you have an execution and then a routinization. And you can see that if you carry on the brain imaging during this process, you find that the prefrontal parietotemporal cingulate cortex are being illuminated by the activity that you record through the brain imaging, and that when you have a routine, then you the activity is much less important, and as you can see, there is no activity then being developed into the workspace. So this means that we can simulate, this is a simulation, a cognitive task which is using the global neuronal workspace to link between the name of the word and the color of the link and have the correct assignment as a function of the perception by the subject. So this is something that can be further investigated, and we thought also of another task which would be perhaps simpler, which is a masking task. And in this masking task, we ask the subject to look at these slides. These are masks. This is no slide. This is the word lion. And here you put the two masks and the word between two masks. In one case, you ask the subject, do you see something? And he said, yes, I can read the word lion. Now, here, you ask the subject, do you see something? And he said, no. So the word note has been, in fact, processed. There are proofs for that, but non-consciously. So you can have here a conscious versus a non-conscious processing. And these are the brain images you get from conscious versus non-conscious processing. Now, you can further use this masking task and compare, for instance, through EEG, conscious versus in red versus non-conscious processing. And you find it essentially here in the prefrontal cortex. And if you look at the critical response that you can find it, it's rather slow. It takes about 200 to 300 milliseconds. And you have what we call together with Stanislas an ignition here, and then some kind of self-sustained activity. So you could say, well, you have a lot of imagination, Stanislas and yourself. You have been inventing things. You are confronting the reality with your own tools. Well, we were very happy, both of us, to have recently a work being done by another group of Rolf Sema. And here is the recording of a stimulus in V1, V2, and then conscious processing. And you can see the shape, which is the same as the one we also observed and simulated. So this is, if I may say, at this stage, proof that there is a different activity in the brain for conscious versus non-conscious processing. And I perhaps would say, by reference with Descartes, that here we have a res cogitans and here a res extensa. This is a pure speculation. Now, having said that, let's just switch to the molecular level. Now, you know, I mentioned that in the course of human evolution, there is some kind of increase of size. Let's say more than doubling about from Australopithecus to Homo habilis to Homo erectus to Homo sapiens. The recent studies of the genome of Homo sapiens and by Svante Szabo of Neanderthalensis, let us compare all these genomes together with those of other animal species and try to look within the genome what is characteristic of the human brain and what is characteristic of access to consciousness, which is so unique to the human brain as far as all the different levels of organization I just mentioned before for the conscious processing. So, first of all, the detailed study of Jean-Jacques Hublin recently shows that there is some kind of continuity from Homo erectus to Homo neanderthalensis, and maybe a little jump from neanderthalensis to sapiens, even though these two species coexisted for a while, and that about 5% of our genome is from neanderthalensis. Maybe some of us have more neanderthalensis than others. This is indeed the case. But on the average, it's about 5%. And if we take all the different human species which has been studied, human individuals, there is about 30% of the genome of Homo neanderthalensis in the genome of Homo sapiens. So this is an interesting situation. And everybody thought, oh, we are going to have the solution of what I mentioned before. And looking at the genome of the mouse, of the fly, and of humans, you can see that from the mouse to humans, there is no change in the number of genes. Now, when you look at the number of neurons, you have here 13,000 genes, 250,000 neurons, 40 million, 80 billion. So is it not that an interesting paradox? Some of our friends who are physicists or informaticists may have a solution in their mind to account for that. Well, we have to deal with it. And if we really want to understand the human brain, we have to understand this paradox. Now you may say, oh, this is okay. The structural genes we have in our genome, I mentioned the percentage of genome from Homo neanderthalensis, the percentage of genes should tell us something. Well, when this was done by Guillaume Dumas recently, it's being submitted, it's a very interesting theory. When you look at the protein from the brain and those from the testes and the liver or the kidney and the lung, which one are the most conserved? Those from the brain. Isn't that amazing? So the solution is not there. And where is the solution? Well, the solution is in the regulation of expression of genes. And there we are back to the beginning, to Jacques Monod and the operon model. This, you may know, we have regulatory genes which code for so-called transcription factors, and then we have genes which are being modulated in cis by these transcription factors. But in the first presentation of the model in 61, they assumed that these were RNAs which were involved in the regulation. And then came the allosteric protein. I am not going to discuss that more. Maurizio gave a nice explanation about that. And then, thanks to Jacques Monod, my name was included in the revisited operon model, which in fact postulated that the lac repressor is an allosteric protein which undergo allosteric transition, like an enzyme, and or hemoglobin. And then the idea is that, in fact, instead of having simple genes coding for brain function, we have groups of genes, assemblées of genes. And there is, of course, for those who may have thought about it from you, the assembly, a combinatorial aspect, which is, of course, very large and could be usefully displaying variability and diversity to code for the phenotype of the human brain. And therefore, this is an idea that I developed together with Igor Tsigani when I was in San Diego, and still we are continuing to that. And the idea that we may have assembled genes, assemblies of genes, which may code for brain functions. So this is an illustration of the use of the system biology approach with the data published in the literature on the expression of genes in the cerebral cortex. And there are indeed groups of genes which are coded by transcription factors, and these transcription factors are even making a hierarchy and are organized during the development to code for the different components of the human brain. And of course, we immediately thought, if this is true, then we should have a way to understand the relationship between the inheritance of some brain disease, like schizophrenia or autism, and the phenotype of the brain. Clearly, what is missing in the schizophrenic, and this has been experimentally shown, is a normal access to consciousness. There is some interference there, which is caused by the disease, and the relationship with other people and the representation they have of the social world is perturbed, among many other things. So the idea is that perhaps there is a simple relationship between the the genes, or the assemblies of genes, and the phenotype of schizophrenia or autism. And the fact is, still a paradox, that the number of predisposition genes to schizophrenia is at least 100, and the number of predisposition genes to autism is perhaps as high as 500. So I said there is a parsimony in the number of genes in the genome, and then when we look at this disease, we find that there are many genes among this small number which are coding for disease. So the idea is that perhaps we could build this transcription factor networks I just mentioned to you before to try to further understand the deficit in consciousness which is made by these predisposition genes. And therefore, we should forget about what was still currently said in the media, in particular the gene of intelligence, the gene of math, the gene of language, and so on and so forth. This is simply wrong. There is not a single gene for intelligence. It does not exist. There is not a single gene for vision or whatever. There are mutations which can give you a predisposition to deafness, to decrease IQ or whatever, or language deficit, but there is not one gene for each of these brain functions. So I think the conclusion we are reaching here is that we think that, in fact, a network of gene assemblies, in fact, code for neuronal networks. And there is not a single relationship between one gene and one network of neuron in our brain. So the studies are being done there, and the idea is many of these genes are involved in synapse formation. And the conclusion we can say, and it is still a possibility, that we have, as I say, a complex relationship between gene assemblies and assemblies of neurons, and perhaps, please or not, that the same genes that drive us mad, which are in fact involved in schizophrenia or in autism, are also those which have made us humans, which is not a very positive way of looking at our higher brain functions, but which may have some truth. Now, I will discuss another aspect and then conclude. So, the other aspect is the relationship between gene expression and the connectivity of the brain. So, there is still in the literature a lot of people who say, oh, this is an innate disposition, which is simply due to the assembly of genes I just mentioned before. In fact, what I would like to say now is that there is process, which is, an evolutionary process, which is being involved in the development of our brain and which interconnects the network of genes with the network of neurons and reach the case of the long-range connectivity, which I mentioned before, and the access to consciousness. Now, the first thing that you can see here is that the newborn has a brain which is 5 times smaller than the adult brain. Now, if you count the number of synapses which are being established in a second, when you look at your grandson in the eye for 1 second, how many synapses are formed? Well, at least 1 million, perhaps more. So you can imagine that there is, in fact, in our brain, an extraordinary dynamic of synaptogenesis which is taking place after birth. And when you do an experiment with a child, you have to be very careful because you start with a number of connections and you end up with a different one, which is a real problem to do a reliable experiment with children. But whatever, you have to deal with it. And the idea is that, I introduced it already in the beginning, that you have nested steps of synapse formation. And that has some of these steps. You have some selection of synapses which is taking place. And you may also imagine that there is some reward which is involved in this relationship between the development of synapse and the interaction with the outside world. So we have formalized this model. And this is of interest with those interested with neuromorphic computers, because those who are making neuromorphic computers usually don't take into consideration the building up of the connection that they have in their computer. And there is a biochemistry and a pharmacology, and I'm pleased to say that in this synapse selection, most likely some growth factor are being used for the selection of some of the synapses, the stabilization of some of them, the elimination of others. So I would just like to illustrate this relationship between the development of the brain and the outside world with only 1 slide. I'm sorry to be so short, but time is passing, which is, in fact, the occurrence of what I called cultural circuits in the brain. And the best example is that of writing and reading. You know that writing and reading was invented by humanity 6,000 or 8,000 years ago, and it was not predetermined genetically, but simply there was, I would say, a genetic envelope which let this process develop into their brain. And as you can see here, if you can compare it compare the brain of a literate with an illiterate. This is by brain imaging. You see, for instance, here in the prefrontal cortex, a very striking difference between literate and illiterate. And this is further studied by Stanislas Dehaene for the whole brain, where there is a very different stabilization of different networks for those who have learned a given language and those who have not learned the language. And for the case of the ideographic versus alphabetic language, there are differences in the circuits which are present in our brain. So it means that there is an effect of the interaction with the outside world to selectively stabilize synapses during this development that I just mentioned throughout my brain. And now we are reaching the conclusion. If you look at the autistic child, I mentioned that there is a deficit in conscious processing in these children. Then the idea is that, and this was proposed by Belmonte quite a while ago, that there is a capacity of integration and therefore some kind of long-range connections which are missing in the autistic child to the benefit of short-term short connections. This was proposed by Belmonte, and this has been confirmed, as you can see here, with brain imaging, with ASD infants and toddlers in blue and red, while the long-range connection in white do not change. So it means that, that the consequence of the development, this long-range connection have been lost, and therefore that there is some relationship between the pattern of gene expressed, the epigenesis with the outside environment, and the stabilization of the long-range connectivity in the brain of the autistic children, which is altered compared to the normal infant. So this leads us to conclude that if we want to have a system biology approach to the study of the brain, we should take into consideration not only the higher cognitive function, as I did at the beginning of my presentation, not only the issue of gene expression that I mentioned, but also the pattern of gene express, but also the epigenetic relationship between the pattern of gene express and the interaction with the outside world leading to the formation of the mature or adult networks. So it's a system biology approach, which include the psychocognitive one, the electrophysiological one, and of course, one cannot do it without the help of the physicists who are present here through computational models and artificial intelligence. Now, this is going to enhance multidisciplinarity. And this is, of course, very important for us if we want to develop some pharmacology of higher brain function, and particularly of brain disease, for which we have very little to propose. Now, I will conclude. C'est fini. This talk could end with a far-fetched hypothesis, which is, how can we view the evolution of the human brain from, let's say, Homo erectus to Homo sapiens? What is happening there? So I said there were some few regulatory phenomena which would take place. And the proposal I made is that a simple doubling of the number of cortical neurons might be sufficient to explain the difference between the Homo erectus and the Homo sapiens. Why? Because there might be some non-linear relationship between the development of the long-range connectivity and the number of neurons which establish this connectivity, that when you double the number of neurons, you have a much more complex network which become established. The capacity of the global neuronal workspace may go from one item to seven items in just a doubling of the neuron. You have epigenesis which is taking place, and you may perhaps account at least for a number of the differences which make Homo sapiens different from Homo erectus, since in this transition, if we change the capacity of the neuronal workspace, you introduce language and you have an enormous diversity, in particular of culture, of system of belief, of language, of tradition, which account for what we are. So, do you like my brain? This is a very nice picture by Nikit Sinfal. It's a little bit simple-minded, but it may work. Thank you very much. These are so these are those who are involved: Antoine Danchin, Stanislas, Thomas Bourgeron, and a few others. I have.
Thank you very much.
Discuss.
Thanks a lot.
Sorry for being
wonderful.
A bit long.
Chiudere quello. No, chiudere quello. Se no siamo accecati. Thank you very much. Please, if we have some questions. Del microfono al professor Berlucchi.
Thank you, Jean-Pierre. How do you place the hippocampal formation within the global workspace? And in the process of humanization, I think there is also an increase before the cerebral cortex also of the hippocampal formation, including the entorhinal cortex.
I agree with you. I said from the beginning that it was not exclusive of the prefrontal cortex, which is something which is debated with us. You know, some people like Christophe Corr say, oh, you are putting too much emphasis on the prefrontal cortex. But as I showed, and we were also in agreement with Patricia Goldman-Rakish, who remember the network, I said it's a minimal network, but it might include other system and those you are mentioning. So I have nothing against that and the opposite, but you know, it cannot be the whole brain also. So it has to be, or you have to find one feature which characterizes the fact that you are in the global neuronal workspace. So the feature we propose is that this is the long-range connectivity. And the interesting aspect, and I had this morning some kind of confirmation from one of colleague I met in HBP, who is studying very carefully, he's a German guy who is doing this extremely carefully, establishing the relationship between the pyramidal cells in the cortex and the long and short range connection. And he does not, I would say, he does not reject our hypothesis bluntly. He says, this is an interesting idea that we have to quantitatively demonstrate. Now, he asked me a question: how can you measure the capacity of the global neuronal workspace? So I gave this famous Miller experiment. But perhaps I am looking now for brain imaging studies, which may show the difference of size, let's say, in the chimp and in humans. But that's where we are. So it's just an hypothesis, simple-minded. Let's say what we can do with that for the big. But one thing which is clear is that the hominization process has taken place without many. It's not God which put the spirit in the brain. It's a number of genes which change in our genome. And this cannot be a large number. You know, there are only a few number of neurons. And there is some kind of regulatory event which took place, or a few regulatory events which took place between, let's say, Australopithecus and Homo sapiens, and which gave this global expansion, which has a go through a critical step and brought language. And Chomsky says, humans, before, let's say, 50,000, 100,000, he does not specify that, did not have language, and suddenly they had language. So to my proposal, it is simply due to an effect on the global works. It's very, very simple-minded. There was a question.
Yes.
My question is not directly on the brain. I know virtually nothing about the brain, and I sometimes doubt whether I have one myself. But on the modeling that you do, are you using nonlinear thermodynamics? Because you mentioned at the beginning the work of Prigogine.
Yes, yes, yes.
And he introduced nonlinear thermodynamics.
We actually, not I can tell you that I have been working with Ilya Prigogine myself. Yeah. And I think he had the interesting idea of stable thermodynamic states, yeah. His dissipative structure under condition where there is an exchange with the outside world. And at this time, it was 40 years ago, if I may say.
Yes.
We agree together about this, and the brain in particular, because clearly through the epigenesis story, if you remove the, not only the interaction with the outside world, but also the spontaneous activity in the system, which he did not so much consider, Prigogine himself, then you, if you suppress that, then the brain dies. So it's death. So recently, there have been some physicists who have come back to a spin glass model of the brain, which we also developed. This is one of the first papers I did with Stanislas, with a physicist in Paris. And we did not go very far from that. But some physicists, as Haim Sompolinsky now in Israel, is indeed making some story about that. But I am myself not very much attracted by that. Even though there might be some interesting output of it, maybe.
Because my problem here is that Prigogine worked in the linear part.
Yes.
The linear area of the non-equilibrium thermodynamics, yes. That is very close to equilibrium. And certainly, I don't know anything about the brain, as I've said, but certainly in a cellular context, most of cellular networks are far from equilibrium, and they're outside the linear regime of Prigogine. I don't know whether that's the case with respect to the brain.
No, but just to answer, I don't know if I answer it correctly, but the way we modelize the global neuronal workspace from the beginning is that we have a network of reciprocally connected neurons, and we further formalize this in the case of the of the masking task by having a reafference, which is very important. So it means that the system is highly nonlinear. And that's also a reason why we think that there is some relatively sharp transition between awake and sleep. So there is some aspect of non-linearity to take into consideration. And for instance, this, I'm trying to modelize that with a friend on general anesthesia. When you look at general anesthesia, you have very suddenly a loss of consciousness. Unfortunately, only a set of neurons are being involved there. Otherwise, we would be dead. If the general, you never thought about that, perhaps, but if the general anesthetics was acting so on all our neurons the same way, we would be killed. So it means that there are, it's, I think for me, a very strong argument that there is very specialized architectures for consciousness. Because, and in fact, these are the only people I know in science who are using consciousness without any kind of apprehension. You know, they are okay with that. When they have a patient, they say, well, there is a loss of consciousness. You know, anesthesists don't hesitate. With physiologists, it's very different. But anesthesists, they always say that. So it means that there is some highly non-linearity in the brain. And you know, this is an old history for the physiologists who are present here, which is the issue of reafference, and which means that, in fact, you, and also feedback with the cybernetic, that you, and Edelman with also the issue of re-entry, that you need non-linearity to build up this kind of model. That's for sure. In all our models, it's the case. Thank you for making this point. It's a very important one.
I had a simple question. I missed something. With this global neuronal workspace,
yes. Right?
This seems like an extended hands over the whole brain?
Yes.
Or, and now is this consistent with the fact that there are areas that are involved in specific functions?
You are pointing to an issue which has been debated between Christoph Koch and Stanislas and myself, because the claim is that the primary visual cortex, I don't know how the distinguished physiologists who are here react to that, but the primary visual cortex is not directly connected to the global neuronal workspace.
Uh-huh.
And this German fellow I just mentioned actually have confirmed that there are less long-range connectivity reaching the visual, primary visual cortex than, for instance, the temporal, or parietotemporal, or cingulate areas. So the cingulate being very reafferented. So this has to be further investigated in detail. And it would be extremely interesting for us if we could label the axons which are involved in the conscious processing and those which are not. But this is for the future.
More questions, please? Yes. Gian Domenico.
So thank you
very
much.
Speak up.
Here.
Yep, thank you very much. I have a comment and a question about your ignition theory.
Yes.
And you very nicely reinterpreted a very old phenomenon, which is the P300.
Yes.
As a transient activity which ignites and leads to consciousness.
Yes.
And the problem that I have, and also some others have with this idea, is that sometimes to get the P300, you need a very transient stimulus.
Yes.
Whereas with slow rising stimuli, which do not elicit a P300, they are undeniably consciously perceived.
Yes.
So the correlation between P300 and consciousness yes. seems to be valid in some instances, but not always. So it doesn't seem to be obligatory. So I don't know if you have any comment on that.
Yes, but I share
what is P300? What is P300? What is P300?
No, I agree with you. I did not set the P300. I see some event taking place in 300 millisecond time scale. And you can call it P300 as a distinctive phenomenon, which I never did. I'm very pragmatic and phenomenological there. We have been using one type of experiment. We see this kind of phenomenon. And this has been reproduced by Rolf Zema. It's a paper in Science, as you can see. That's it. Now, I don't want to say that this is a universal signature of consciousness, but at least, let's say that in this particular case, it is. How broad is the phenomenon, and could we have some more discrete physiological phenomena taking place? I would be extremely happy if they could be discovered, I may say, because this may, and yourself may have some ways to assess that there is a difference. But what I am very strong on it, is and what I personally am very deeply attached to, is that there is a particular physiology for conscious processing versus non-conscious one. And that's the thing we have to look at for. And I am not certain that the method which has been used by following EEG or brain imaging are the right ones. And what we have been doing at Pasteur, come and we can discuss that, is that in humans, like in the mouse, there are some sharp waves of coherent activity of neurons which is taking place globally in the brain. And they are taking place every few seconds. They are ultra-slow fluctuations. And the very interesting thing is that we can find them in the mouse. They are sensitive to general anesthetics. And they are sensitive to the nicotinic receptor. So there is even a pharmacology there. Whether they do represent, they are a sign of conscious processing, I think so. But we have to further demonstrate that. So they would be, if you wish, some kind of ignition-like, but not really ignition as it is being seen in the case of perceptual experiments.
Thank you very much. If there are no more questions, I think we may thank again Jean-Pierre for this wonderful conference.